Hi guys, so I'm Sonali Gupta and I am here and we are going live today with Paras Health. It is a very, very exciting day and it's so nice to see you all joining us here. So let's wait for a few people to join us and then we are going to begin this session. All right. Hi everybody, hi. So we have a request from, okay, great.
Hey. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, Dr. Kriplani. How are you?
Hi. I don't know your name, but you are too beautiful.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kriplani.
I thought I'll see the heroine.
Oh my God. How sweet of you to say that. I'm Sonali Gupta. And it's really, really lovely to have you here with us today.
So sweet.
So I just... Thank you. So this is our first ever session where we are going live with Paras Health. And I really hope all our viewers have been having a great year. And I wish you all a very stupendous, a very special, a very successful 2021. Now, we are starting this year with a bang. We are absolutely honored to have with us Dr. Kriplani. I will be talking about her credentials in a few minutes. But before that, I want to tell you a bit about Paras Healthcare. So Paras Healthcare was established in the year 2006. With a mission that we wanted to provide the best quality medical service with utmost responsibility and compassion at affordable prices. Paras Healthcare is a chain of hospitals that is providing super specialty tertiary care. Each one of its initiatives is based on three tenets, and they are very clear: affordability, accessibility, and quality. Paras Healthcare has been working on the principle of bridging the gap by providing exceptional medical expertise, the infrastructure and technology to areas that lack the same. Especially our Paras has been able to initiate healthcare in rural areas with Paras Patna, Paras Darbhanga, Paras Gurgaon, along with Paras Panchkula. So moving on, we would also like to talk to you all about Dr. Kriplani. We are very excited. We have started with these sessions called Doc Talk, and we have decided to get on board some of the most renowned and celebrated doctors in their field. Dr. Kriplani is a Padma Shri awardee, the best gynecologist in Gurgaon. She is a gynae lap surgeon. She has been very well taking care of high-risk pregnancies, and she is also a fertility expert, specializing in artificial reproductive technology. She comes with an extensive experience of over 40 years in gynecologist and obstetrician. She has received over 47 awards and has been honored with the very special Padma Shri by the President of India for her distinguished service in the field of medicine for the year 2015. Ma'am, it is an absolute honor for us to have you here with us.
Thank you so much for the lovely introduction. And I'm really enjoying and impressed with the lovely, beautiful anchor.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It's an honor, of course, to be here. So I know that you've delivered over 860 guest lectures. You have been a part of over 400 scientific publications and 403 abstract publications. You've also written 4 books. And I know that you're very senior in your field and you have a lot of knowledge. You know, today we wanted to discuss a very, very important and crucial topic, which is women healthcare and, of course, pregnancies. Especially, you know, I'm also a mother of 2. And I think it is something that has become such a need of the hour. You know, we women are often so busy becoming good wives, great home care takers, good mothers, fantastic daughter-in-laws, that we forget to really take care of ourselves. And, you know, we really put our health behind somewhere and we really forget about ourselves. So before we begin, I want you to tell us a bit more about why women healthcare is so important today.
As you very rightly said, women neglect themselves. And somehow it is our culture, or I don't know, the psychology is very wrong, that they behave like martyrs. And I always say, if a female in the family is healthy, then only the family will be healthy. If a female is, happy, then only she can spread happiness to the children and the family and the in-laws. So these two things are very important. It is not being selfish. It is being, self-aware and a good, good house. I would say that she is the owner. Basically, she is the boss of the house. You have to take care of yourself if you really want to keep your family healthy.
Oh, absolutely. And I think... awareness is the right term that you've used. It's all about being aware of yourself so that you can become a better mother, a better daughter, a better wife. And I think that is what makes all the difference.
So unless you are better, how can you make people better?
But I totally agree with something you said, which was brilliant, that unless and until you are happy, you cannot keep anybody else happy. So unless and until you're healthy, how can you keep a healthy family if you're not well? Then how will your family be happy without you? So I think you're absolutely right. So is there something that you, when women come to you, is there something that you often notice in them? Is there some little problem? Do you notice a few things in women that you say, I always notice these women, they are always ignoring themselves or they're too worried about other people. Do you always see that?
I always notice that the women, especially middle-aged ones, they neglect their health like anything. 60 to 70% come with anemia, they have bleeding problem, and they don't come forward. They say, mere bacche ka exam tha, my husband had promotion, my husband was out of station. They take their health as last priority, and that's really very sad state of affairs.
Oh, absolutely. Dr. Kriplani, I've just had a second baby, and my baby is about 2.5 months. And I'm telling you, being a mother, it is a constant state of being in guilt. You're always guilty. You want to work, but then you feel guilty if you're working. And if you're at home, then you feel guilty that you're not working. Then if you do anything, you feel guilty about not eating or eating. So tell me something. How can we deal with this guilt?
I think this is a very, very important area you have touched. Because I myself has gone through it. When you have second baby and first baby is just going to nursery or started school, that's the worst part of your, household responsibilities, because there are too many. And that is the part when career-wise you are so busy in that age. So it's very difficult to balance. I think husbands and menfolk in the house have to understand. And we have to come out of the psychology that the housekeeping is whole sole responsibility of the female. And I tell you, nowadays I see many men coming forward and helping their wives. But still, we have to go a long way. But as you said, coming out of guilt, it is very easy to say that we should, treat ourselves equal and all. But the thing is, the way we are brought up, that goes very deep rooted in our psyche. It won't go out in a day. My nanny will say, somebody's mother-in-law will say, oh, what kind of mother you are, leaving the baby, baby's crying. All these things, unknowingly, they put so much of pressure. And being a mother, it's not easy. These men should realize, being a mother, it is a physical strain, it is a mental strain, it is a big emotional strain. Because a child who is very small can pass all the feelings to the mother. Mother realizes that. So we need to have better family support system. Men folk in the house and other people have to realize that what a girl is going through, and this postpartum depression is so common. On the top of it, this gender issue in our society, my God. So I have seen females suffering like anything. Gradually it will go away, but we ourselves are to be blamed. Having said that, how many of us are empowered? You, the my beautiful anchor and me, we are amongst those 1% of women who have say in the family financial matters, or we are financially independent. Think of these other 99% of women who are economically dependent and who have no say. Combined families has its own advantages, but as I said, we are in a very bad transition phase where females, their stereotype, their roles are looked upon in a different way, and husbands expect a beautiful, a working and earning wife. So we females are caught in a very difficult time zone presently, I'll say, but I tell you, nobody will come to help. You have to help yourself. You have to be mentally strong. You have to work hard, and you have to find your own support system.
Oh, absolutely. So well said, Dr. Kriplani. I think it is also, you know, that belief system has been so strongly imbibed in us that, you know, you're supposed to take care of your child. You're supposed to do everything. You're supposed to. So, you know, that inner conscious also keeps kind of, you know, troubling us, and we keep constantly questioning ourselves. Are we doing the right thing? Am I doing the right thing? So, you know, I think you've put it so beautifully. Nobody is going to come to your help. You have to help yourself. And I think you are absolutely right when you say that. Now, while we're talking about this, we also today want to discuss some very serious issues. You know, before we started going into this live session, we started doing a little bit of survey. We started asking women some questions, and we came up with a series of very commonly asked questions, things that were really disturbing them. These were things that were related to periods, fibroids, you know, and many other issues. So today I would like to just jump into it and talk about it. So should we start?
Yes, yes. I'm all yours. Okay.
All right. So we had somebody ask us a question, that what is endometriosis and can it have an effect on pregnancy?
Very good question. There are some diseases, endometriosis, fibroids. In our olden books, it is written, if a lady does not become pregnant in good age, the uterus, if it is not harboring a child, it will start harboring fibroids, endometriosis, adenomyosis. Actually, God never meant, and nature never meant, that the fertility should be so much delayed. See, in good olden times, they were getting married early, in early 20s, they were having children. When I was a young doctor, in my OPD, whole day I used to counsel how to prevent a child and the medical MTPs and aborting unwanted pregnancies. Now, every other patient in my OPD is with infertility. They are not able to have children. What is wrong? It is our lifestyle. It is urbanization. It is basically delaying fertility beyond physiological limits. Having said that, saying is easy, but girls nowadays want to be independent. They are career conscious. Nothing wrong in that. They have to compete in this men's world. So it gets delayed. There is no immediate solution to this problem. Now you ask me about endometriosis is a disease. If somebody has periods, and they are heavy, some amount of blood goes back, or there are so many etiologies, I won't go into it, but endometriosis is a disease when there are cysts in the abdomen and in the near the ovaries where the blood gets collected, and gradually there are other organs like fallopian tubes, like bowel, they get adherent, and the patient gets very bad pain in the menstruation cycle, and she has pain in meeting with the partner, and they are not able to have children if the disease is advanced. So this is endometriosis. It is namesake, it is not a cancer, but it is a very, very devastating disease because it leads to so much of pain and the girl is so much miserable. And this is, as I said, it is a problem of urbanization, industrialization, and we are seeing in our practice, it is getting very, very common. So if you have pain during periods, if you have dyschezia, like pain during defecation, if you have bowel problems, if you have pain meeting your husband or partner, then you must get an ultrasound which will clinch the diagnosis.
And as you said earlier, it does have an effect on pregnancy, that you can't get pregnant and all of that. So according to you, if I may ask, what is the right age to have children, according to you? I mean, according to science.
That is something we should know. According to science, right age will be 20s. But we hardly see now girls coming to us in 20s. And here in Gurgaon, I see it's very common at 34, 35, 33, you ask her, what are the prospects of marriage if you are suffering from endometriosis? She says, abhi to maine ladka mila hi nahi. And if they are married, then 4-5 years they are married. She's 35, 36. Abhi to mere exam bache hain, career nahi, main settle hui. Abhi to maine pregnancy ki sochi nahi. These are very common answers we get. And nobody has answered to this issue. So it is certainly not the ideal age. Fertility decreases in 30s and drastically it increases after 35. So beyond 35, it's really getting pregnant may become a problem.
Okay, so here the doctor, we are very clear na ki the problem is not with the girls, the problem is with boys. Ladke nahi milte. Every girl is only has one problem. Ladke
bhai sare ladkiyan kehti hai ki ladke to bahut milte hain, theek ladka marriage material nahi milta
hai. This is a problem with the boys. I must say. Okay, so here this gets us to the next question. And here's somebody asking that I'm 30 years old and I've been wanting to have a baby. I have tried for more than 1 year now. How long should I wait to consult a doctor or should I keep trying myself?
Very good. If you have not conceived and you are cohabiting, living with a husband for constantly for 1 year and you are 30 years, definitely you should see a fertility specialist, a good gynecologist, and they will just tell you some simple pregnant three basic things are important: husband's sperms, female's eggs, and the patent, you know, tract, genital tract as a conduit. So simple tests like doing a semen analysis of the husband. Sometimes there is some infection, sometimes his counts are not very good, sometimes they have so much of alcohol and smoking, so we can correct that. And the female, her periods are not regular, she may be, this PCOD problem is so common. So if she has all those issues, get an ultrasound done. Suppose there is a tumor inside, the fibroid inside, endometriosis, so you come to know. And then checking for the patency. So seeing these basic tests, it's very important. Suppose you are suffering from something and you are just unnecessarily wasting your time, it's not a good idea. So you must go get yourself checked. Simple tests are done, basic tests are done, so that if they are all right, then when allowed, okay, you try for some more time. And nowadays, reproductive medicine has advanced so much. Not any field of medicine, I think, is not as much advanced as is the IVF and ART reproductive medicine, where the world has reached now. So it is very important to get timely help. We are not going to give a very drastic advice, but we are going to help giving simple advices when to meet in the cycle. When are the chances of pregnancy bright? These things help so many people and they are able to achieve pregnancy with simple advices.
Oh, that's fantastic. So it's a good idea to visit a doctor if you've been trying for over a year and you're 30 years old. So here we have another question. This is from a lady who's 34 years old. And she says, I have never conceived and I'm having difficulty having a baby. I have severe pain during my periods and I have been diagnosed with endometriotic cyst. Can this be cured by medicines or a surgery is recommended? The size of each cyst is approximately 6 centimeters.
This is a very, very good question. Even there are controversies in our science. We 10 experts, if we sit in a single patient, we may have little different opinions. But then we practice by guidelines and our societies, our experts sit and make guidelines. So the guidelines are, if endometriosis is less than 4 centimeters, if it is not leading to severe symptoms, we try with conservative ways. And there are so many medicines which are effective, because endometriosis may be having pain, may be having excessive bleeding during periods. So we take care of that. But if the disease goes beyond a point, like if the cysts are 6 centimeters, she is having severe pain, then they may require surgery. And nowadays we don't cut open for endometriosis. 100% of time we operate them with laparoscopy. So with laparoscopy, it is minimally invasive. We remove the disease, we reconstruct, we conserve organs, and that is how we relieve her of her pain. And what I would like to say, it's not a good idea to get repeated surgeries done for endometriosis. The best chance to operate a patient of endometriosis is when she wants to conceive, because every surgery puts insult to the injury, and with every surgery her ovarian reserve goes down, her chances of conception becomes less. So with having a balanced view, taking the patient along, if it is not a very big disease, with the medicines, if she is married, wants to have a baby, if she has a baby, the disease gets suppressed for many months and years. If she is not able to achieve pregnancy, removing the disease laparoscopically, being very conservative with the ovaries, preserving ovaries, and then allowing her to become pregnant is the way to treat this problem. And there are many medicines which are quite effective in alleviating symptomatology of endometriosis.
Oh, excellent. So nothing much to worry about. It could be a non-invasive surgery and it can be taken care of. So here we have another question that we have. There's a lady, she's 28 years old and she's having very heavy bleeding. She says, I have been diagnosed with 10 centimeter fibroid and I am trying for pregnancy. My doctor has suggested surgery. Should I go in for a surgery or should I try for pregnancy?
Wow, this is another very, very important question. Like, you are talking to me about fibroids. We call in science leiomyoma. In general terms, we say Rasoli, and it is fibroid. Again, fibroids are very, very common. 15 to 20%, 25% of females have fibroid. If they are very small fibroids, we don't bother about it. But it depends on the location of the fibroid. If they are protruding inside the uterine cavity or leading to symptoms. So more important than size is the location and what symptoms, what trouble fibroid is giving to the lady. Not every fibroid requires removal to become pregnant. So many patients become pregnant with fibroids. But we have to take care of what is the size of fibroid, what is the location of fibroid, what kind of fibroid it is, how many fibroids she has. 10 centimeters is a pretty big size of fibroid, because being too conservative also is not a good idea sometimes. If it is fast growing, there may be cancer in it. If it is a very big fibroid and it keeps growing, it will destroy the normal myometrium around. So that also becomes an issue. So a good gynec, good surgeon has to really evaluate every patient on its merits and to take decision whether to remove these fibroids. And again, the good news is nowadays we remove these fibroids in a very minimally invasive way. I think I super specialize in this field. Daily, literally daily, I operate myomectomy. Myomectomy is you remove the fibroid and you repair the uterus. And after repairing, give her a few months and then she can go for conception. So it depends on location and type and patient's profile. Suppose she wants IVF, she's late age, then even smaller fibroids, because IVF results are directly affected by the fibroid and its size and its location. And if they're protruding inside uterus, then even small fibroids lead to a lot of symptoms like heavy periods, like severe pain in periods. So we remove them hysteroscopically. In that, absolutely no cut. Nowadays, science has advanced so much. Absolutely no cut is required. And we relieve her, or if problem, we remove the fibroids.
Oh, that's excellent.
Having said that, many patients come with pregnancy with fibroid. All sizes of fibroids. So we take care. And suppose she requires cesarean section for any other indication, at that time, we can remove her fibroids. And we do that. Okay. We have a lot of work. You can go on to YouTube and just type Alka Kriplani and you will see my work on fibroid for infertility, fibroid for bad obstetric history, fibroid for abnormal uterine bleeding, and cesarean myomectomy, where we remove fibroids at the time of cesarean.
Oh, that's So I think that pretty much gets us to our next question, which is actually about a man, about a gentleman who's asked us that my wife is 5 months pregnant and she has a fibroid in her uterus. Will it cause any problem to the pregnancy? Do we need to take any special steps during the pregnancy?
As I said, it's very important to know location and size and type. So if it is a small fibroid, it may not bother at all. But if fibroids are multiple or are big, there is evidence, like we collect thousands of cases and then we publish that how many had vis-a-vis compared to normal pregnant lady and the one who had fibroids, what was the difference in outcome? So there is higher risk of abortion, higher risk of growth retardation, higher risk of preterm birth, higher risk of cesarean section. If fibroid comes in the way during cesarean, like where we cut open in the lower segment anteriorly, if fibroid is lying in that location, in that case, it may lead to problem during, cesarean section. And we have to absolute indication to remove that fibroid because it is coming in our incision line. Otherwise, old teaching was that if the fibroid is there in pregnancy, give her rest, right? And you should not touch the fibroid in pregnancy because vascularity is more. And at the time of cesarean, it was not advised to remove fibroids. But now surgeries have advanced so much. Surgeons' experience have advanced so much. So why give her second sitting and we remove fibroid if feasible in the same sitting, in the same go when we are taking out the baby? And not all fibroids require removal. It is only when they are leading to symptoms or they are big or they are coming in incision line, then they are to be. And experience of surgeon is very important. Surgeon should be very proficient in the procedure of cesarean, which majority of us are. But surgeons should also be very proficient in the procedure of myomectomy, which not all gynec are very well trained. So the surgeon who is trained and who is performing both these operations in large numbers can, perform that operation at the same sitting.
No, absolutely. And the next question is, how does this affect, how does age affect the risk in complications?
Age is a very important factor. You see, in 20s, you have so much of energy. In 30s,
yeah.
Okay. 40s, 50s, with aging is something which we may defy. You have two babies, you are not looking like you have two babies, but it is a matter of 5-10 years. Age will show. Aging is not only on the face, aging is on all the organs. My energy level may be different what it was in the 30s. So age is something we cannot defy. We can defy only 5-10 years or so by our maintaining ourselves. So age is a very important factor in all the things, and especially for fertility. Younger mothers, the age of the ova, the young ova have, different quality and different late age females, they have higher incidence of Down syndrome because late age ovas, they are aging ovas. They don't have that much hatching power. They don't have the chances of pregnancy are less. The chances of the baby, which may, healthy or good genetic material. So early pregnancy is a good idea. And I would like to take this opportunity. What we say, one should never have marriages consanguineous and all. The different genetic material gives the best genetic outcome. So that is the reason in old times our people, elders used to say that you should not marry in the relationship and all. Because the genetic pool is better if these intercaste marriages are good for offsprings.
Oh, that's fantastic. So we clear out another aspect here today, not just health. I mean, I think it's a great idea also. And one should open up to newer ideas, So intercaste,
our marriage is welcome. Because a baby gets half of the genetic material is from the father, half from the mother. So the fresher, newer genetic, mating, it gives a better offspring.
Oh, that's
it's
wonderful.
It's a scientifically proven fact.
Oh, that's beautiful.
People
we don't talk about it very
relations,
often.
Relations, like there are some places,
like
some
second relatives,
where they marry in their relations. We see so many diseases in them. Consanguinity leads to set of diseases.
Like what kind of diseases do?
Like
do,
mental
do
retardation, like microcephaly, so many problems.
Really? Just because of the genetics?
It is a scientifically proven.
Not that, my God, this is new to me also. So I think this is very important. One should keep it in mind. And of course, age is a factor.
Marry in relations. It's not that culture is wrong. That thinking is wrong.
It's unhealthy. But I think something that you said absolutely right is, yes, age does have an effect. You know, we all feel it. We all see it. You know,
what is age? We all are here. Tomorrow we will be replaced by younger generation. So age
absolutely.
Is we all will, you know, go one day.
We will all age. Yes, absolutely right. Okay, and when you have two children, you feel much older because you can't keep up with that energy. And you,
see, you
and
I can't feel like I can't. That. It doesn't look like you have two children.
I cannot keep up with them. It's very difficult. Okay.
When you have two children, it is the worst time. In my life, that was the most challenging time. When my elder daughter was 4.5 and the younger was born, we could afford only one maid. And the maid has to go to take her to the school, and who will look after the younger one at home. So she used to take the younger one in the prom. It was really very challenging time in my life.
They have been challenging. Absolutely, absolutely. It is not easy to be working.
It was the most challenging time in my life when I had the younger one born for 6 months to 1 year, and the elder one, because elder one is also used to certain privileges, and the younger one comes and I have to divide my attention. So elder one is also not so happy. So I mean, there are so many issues. And as you said, you really feel guilty, especially from lactation point of view. The day you join your job, it's very difficult to... We have very long hours in our job. So
I'm totally with you. But I think we are lucky as a generation. We are lucky as a generation because we have all those, you know, we have now those electric pumps and everything, which kind of do help us a little bit. But
see,
then, of course,
we think we are lucky. Science is advancing. The new challenges come. Then we overcome that. Then again, newer challenges
again.
Come. And that is the life.
That is life. It's all about having problems and getting over the problems. Absolutely, Dr. Kriplani. Okay, so we have here another question. And this is from somebody. She says, I'm 46 years old and I have very heavy bleeding during menses. I also experience irregular bleeding. Sometimes I bleed twice or thrice in a month, and I have been diagnosed with fibroid. Should I get my uterus removed, or only removal of fibroid will be enough?
I would like to take this opportunity to give 2-3 important messages to my sisters. All those females who are nearing menopause, they think that the excess period, irregular period, you know, they are normal in this age. They are not. They keep on bleeding. And here when I was in All India Institute, I used to see anemia. But here I see patients coming with 6 grams, 7 grams, severe anemia in terminal stage when your heart is about to fail. Then they are brought by their husbands that she is so ill. So please don't wait till that time that your health is, you know, has gone beyond physiological points. These abnormal bleeding, irregular bleeding, they are not a norm for menopause. You are 47 years old. You are bleeding excessively. Go to a gynecologist. Get an ultrasound done. Many of them are suffering from fibroids, as this sister of mine who is asking. And if you have fibroids, not all fibroids require removal. It depends on what is the size, what trouble it is giving you, and what kind of fibroid you are having. And now science has so much advanced. By and large, myomectomy is operation when we remove fibroid and repair the uterus. We do it for younger people or the patients who still want to preserve their fertility or want to produce more children. A patient who is 47, it's not good practice of medicine if she has fibroids, then we tell her we do your myomectomy, because whenever we do conservative surgery, means we remove fibroid and we repair the uterus and leave the uterus behind, there is always a risk of fibroid coming up in that uterus again. So what for you are saving a uterus at 47 years of age? So usually we take a decision of removing the uterus.
Removing.
But if the patient is younger, in my practice daily, literally daily, I operate myomectomy operation for past so many decades, because all those young girls, either they are unmarried or they just want to have a baby, and on examination and they have symptoms, they get ultrasound, they come to know they have big, big fibroids. Then we remove fibroids, repair the uterus, tell them to finish off their fertility, because there is always a risk of recurrence. Especially if fibroids are multiple, there is higher risk of recurrence. And that is how we practice.
Wonderful. So it's a good idea to kind of make sure
but
that you remove the uterus.
But question, who is 47 years old, has 10 centimeter fibroid, she will be better off with hysterectomy. And nowadays we don't cut open. We remove them with minimally invasive way. Like with laparoscopy, you have 3-4 small punctures, 5-10 millimeter tiny. And then we remove fibroids and we remove uterus. So every surgery is done nowadays in a minimally invasive way, laparoscopically or hysteroscopically, so that the patients, they go home next day and their recovery is very fast.
Oh, that's excellent. That is excellent.
That is what is my specialty and work for decades, that I have trained myself as an endoscopic surgeon, laparoscopy and hysteroscopy. That is my first love and passion in my life.
You know, this is really, really very enlightening, because one of my friends, in fact, I know, and she has been going through a similar thing, and she thinks she's going through menopause. So I think
yes,
it's a good
that
time that I'm going to. Yeah, and she's not gone to a doctor yet. In fact, she was discussing with her husband. In fact, I'm going to pick up my phone right now and call her up and tell her that please go to the doctor. Because you're not aware.
Themselves. They should not bleed. Hemoglobin should be at least above 11, should be 12. They come, 70% of my patients who are bleeding around menopause, they come with 6, 7, 8 grams hemoglobin, and their energy level is so low. Their immunity is so low. We have to give blood transfusion. I hate to give unnecessary blood transfusion to patients. But then what to do if they come with such low level of hemoglobin?
Absolutely. I totally agree. So I think it's better, precaution is better than cure, they say. So it's always good to actually go to consult with a doctor, and at least you know.
Rather, they should come for yearly checkup, so that in checkup, if something is there, gets accidentally detected, so they don't have to suffer. Before they suffer, before their immunity goes down, before their hemoglobin goes down, we come to know she has this problem and we fix that problem more effectively.
Absolutely right. I think that is absolutely right. So here we also want to talk, because we have a question that since you're again a specialist in high-risk pregnancies, does a high-risk pregnancy cause medical problems for the baby? That is a question.
Very good question. That depends on what is the high-risk factor, because not every high-risk factor will have impact on the baby. But I tell you, nowadays with late childbearing, with people very conscious, every pregnancy, I think, becomes a high-risk pregnancy. Especially in our country, diabetes, 15 to 16% of our patients, they come out to be, you know, gestational diabetes, which has serious impact on the baby. If you don't control your diabetes properly in pregnancy, outcome of pregnancy may not be good, and your baby is at higher risk of problems later in life. So if you have high blood pressure, again, the baby may be weak. The baby may require to be removed from the womb earlier, prematurely. So common diseases are hypertension, diabetes, then people have heart disease. So there are hundreds of high-risk factors in a female. Not all have adverse effect on the outcome of pregnancy, but because they have effect on the mother's health, then ultimately you might have to remove the baby early, or baby may not get conducive atmosphere in the uterus, so baby may come out weak. This way it may be affected, but there are many genetic diseases. Like if she is having thalassemia minor, husband is minor, baby may be born thalassemia major. So genetic diseases may be transmitted in high-risk pregnancy to the newborn, and then the newborn will suffer. And there are number of genetic diseases which nowadays, with advanced, you know, availability of technology, we detect in utero. So either we can prevent or we can abort an affected fetus. A very common example in the North India is thalassemia major. If husband and wife are carrier, we do chorionic villus sampling in pregnancy. If timely ultrasound is done, and she has many malformations, we terminate that pregnancy. Biggest problem is Down syndrome, that is mental retardation in the baby. Nobody wants to have the risk of having a mentally retarded baby. A Down's baby changes the life of the family, the way you have to take care, the way they have medical problems. So nowadays, if you get your pregnancy properly checked in a good center, we do dual marker, we do level 2 ultrasound,
yes,
required NIPT. So 90%, 99% of time one can detect that this pregnancy, the baby is going to have Down syndrome, is high risk. And if confirmed, we abort that fetus so that that misery to the family can be totally avoided. And that is what we are doing.
Well, that is absolutely right. And I, since I've just had my baby, I know that there are such great, tests today that you can actually find out, how the baby is doing.
Should avail the benefit of availability of science, technology.
And absolutely.
Go to a doctor time to time in pregnancy. Because, an old person who has heart disease, to my mind, more precious than that person's life is the life of the baby who is born today, who is going to survive for 70, 80 years. So that person's health will have longer term implications on the society. So we have to really
absolutely
take health of unborn baby and newborn baby very seriously.
Absolutely. I'm totally with you, Dr. Kriplani. I think this is, I think we just don't take ourselves too seriously, isn't it? Sometimes that is the biggest regret that we have. And I think
sometimes
as a woman, one should say,
people around us do not take us seriously. So both ways it is.
Well, that is true. But the only thing you can do is take yourself seriously. Like you said,
yes,
the
what
only person who can help
at
you.
At least you should do that, and I will go a point beyond. You should make the people take you seriously.
Seriously. Absolutely. Yes. I think, Dr. Kriplani, more than women, I think we should have a session with all the men in you. Especially all the husbands in you.
I can convert many males and they are ignorant. Nobody has told them that how to treat a woman, how to take care of your wife. And we wives, we don't tell them that what is our importance in their life. So really you have to tell people how important you are.
Actually, it is something that passes on. We usually see our parents, and in the older times we have seen the mothers kind of they've been making a lot of sacrifices, and they put themselves behind, and they were always just doing everything for everybody without even thinking how they are.
It's wrong.
So, somehow, yes, it is wrong. And I think this is something that needs to change. So, men need to be, I think we need to hold them and kind of tell them, shake them up and tell them it's time.
But having said that, world over, all the wealth of the world, very small percentage own. It is not only India, unfortunately, it is not only Asia. It is even in the developed country, household worth. Yesterday or day before only, I was seeing the newspaper. 1/10 of the household work is shared all over the world, unfortunately. So we women have to wake up. Whole society has to wake up. Our elders have to wake up. And gender equality is a very, very important issue. Very close to my heart, unfortunately. Lot of work needs to be done in this area.
Absolutely. And we are all with you on that. But, and I think, more than anything else, I think what you've really kind of been talking about is all about a lot to do with your mind. You need to kind of, as a woman, you need to take charge of your mind, of your health.
I will say in one word, you have to make yourself mentally strong, economically independent. And if you have to compete in this man's world, you should be prepared to work double the hard work you should be able to put in if you have to compete with them. That is the success mantra of a female.
Absolutely.
You have to be 10 times better than them to, survive in this man's world.
Oh, absolutely. And why just compete with men? I think it's all about getting better, in yourself. You become a better version of yourself. Why compete with anybody
else?
Very
good. Why
just
compete?
Given.
We are superior.
Why compete?
Why will we compete?
We are absolutely. We are the ones who are taking generations forward, human
they
species forward.
They cannot produce babies.
Absolutely, absolutely. I keep telling my husband, I said, I was pregnant. I gave birth to the baby. At least you give milk to the baby, no?
But please remember, we are those 1% females who are blessed to be economically independent, having very good husbands. Think of all millions of sisters. Go to the villages and see what say they have in family matters, what say they have in financial matters, and how the women are treated. It's
absolutely
not more needs to be done.
Absolutely. But I think if we keep coming up with these small sessions where we really talk about women health,
no,
and
men
awareness,
are not bad. Husbands are not bad. I spend some time with every patient's husband whenever I get time to tell them, and they listen to you.
No, I think the newer generation, you know, Dr. Kriplani, they are really, really very compassionate. They're kind. They're understanding, and they definitely, a lot of them do go beyond and try to help their, you know, the better halves. So I don't think everybody is bad. But yes, of course, some work is needed. And these little sessions are going to help us create that change, isn't it?
Very right.
So you know, having you say all the things you said, having heard you, I think it really lifted up my spirits as a woman today. And I really felt very... You know, I really feel like, you know, being a mother is such a blessing. And, you know, we as mothers, you know, sometimes we also crib and cry a lot. But when we hear these problems,
message.
Yes,
if you have a boy, then I think it is onus is on the mother how to rear the boy. And
absolutely,
the society will fare is how a mother treats her son and teaches him to behave with the future wife. Or with a lady.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, it is a matter of pride, you know, when your son or your husband does something for you, something special. I think as a mother, I would be very proud if my son is a, and he is going to be, if he's a very compassionate husband, I would feel very proud of him.
Why feel proud? So, he will be doing his duty.
Okay, but then it's a great feeling as long as they do it well.
And we are totally drifting from the topic. I'm sure our viewers are enjoying. But let us discuss about paras, what for which we are sitting here today. So
no, absolutely.
I would like to tell Paras Hospital, since I have joined, I have a big team of doctors. We are 10-12 people. I have fellows who have come to learn endoscopy from our Federation of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, and we are doing all type of gynec surgeries here. We are doing all laparoscopic surgeries, hysteroscopic surgeries. I'm a endoscopic surgeon, so more than 95% of my surgeries I'm doing endoscopically. Uterus removal, fibroid removal, prolapse surgeries, everything. Then we have a big team of doctors. 24 hours senior doctors are available. We are catering to high risk pregnancy. We have IVF facilities here, and it's a very good hospital. And what I love about this hospital is, it is like, you know, everybody says Gangaram of Delhi. It is a very moderately priced hospital. And, it, you know, there is absolutely all strata of patients are coming. I have now 12, 13 patients admitted today, out of which 4 are doctors. My practice is basically 2 are gynecologists. But all kind of people coming from Rewari, Bhiwani, Haryana. So every kind of patient is treated at Paras Hospital with equal, you know, responsibility and care. And it's a wonderful facility with all state-of-the-art facilities being available here. So if you have any gynae problem, any obstetric problem, and one thing I would again like to pass on a message before you become pregnant, come for preconception counseling. It is very important. Before you become pregnant, we examine, we come to know whether she's suffering from heart disease, she's having high blood pressure, she's already a diabetic. Because the moment a lady becomes pregnant, the future of the offspring, how healthy it will be, is decided. Because the early months of pregnancy, the baby's organs form. So they must come for preconception counseling. They must come for their checkups, routine checkups, so that before a cancer develops, we are able to pick up or we are able to prevent that cancer. And for gynae problems, I see so many neglected fibroids and endometriosis and severe neglected prolapse cases. Timely intervention is, you know, key to good outcome of our surgery.
Absolutely. You're absolutely right. And when we have doctors who are Padma Shri awardees, it just becomes even more special. So everybody, to all the viewers who are watching us today, I would just like to tell you that
question I have been given by Achal, Srishti Chauhan, she has asked me, I'm 29 years old and I have one baby boy, 3 years old, and I'm having a lower back pain. I had a cesarean section. Srishti, this is a very, very common problem. It may be you lactated, how long you haven't told me. You need to have calcium supplementation during pregnancy and 6 months after delivery during lactation period. Nowadays, many of us are vitamin D deficient. So all these nutritional supplements are important. Proper posture maintenance is important. Your health, your hemoglobin is important. If you are keeping up to all this and your backache is not going away, then take orthopedic consultation. There may be something wrong with the back. So you come, we examine, and we fix your problem. So it may be a very trivial issue. Backache is very common, but there may be something serious underlying. So a proper gynec checkup, proper orthopedic will tell what is the problem, and then, you know, take care of it.
Excellent. Thank you so much, ma'am. I hope that helped you, Srishti. And if you have any questions, you're more than welcome.
If anybody has any question, you are most welcome to ask me. If I know the answer, I'll definitely give.
I'm pretty sure you have all the answers. You know, for all our viewers who are watching us, I just want to say Doc Talk is a show that we have started. It is going to be a weekly show where we are, doctors are going to come in and they're going to answer to any of your common queries and not
By
so
way,
common
very
queries.
Sorry, I was just called from my OPD and was made to sit here. Where is this being transmitted?
This is being transmitted on the Instagram handle of Paras Health. So if you want to know what is happening, if you want to stay
not
updated with all the information, this is not on Facebook. This is on Instagram Live.
But Paras the recording Health. Can be obtained.
Yes,
that recording
because
is going
to
be
on
Facebook.
My Facebook page where I have, you know, 9,000 followers and 5,000 friends. So let everybody, you know, let me enjoy their comments.
Of course, of course. So this is all going to be shared on Facebook, on Instagram. You all can watch the live, you know, recorded later on as well. It might be on the Paras Health page as well. And
so
Doc Talk is a session
where they can again find it.
So, well, I just want to tell all of you that all you need to do is follow Health, Paras Health on Instagram for all the updates. You can see all of this recording there as well. Find all the answers. If you have any other questions, you can go ahead and ask us your questions there. And we will try to answer them on behalf of Paras. I'm sure Dr. Kriplani is going to answer all of your queries. Also, we will be posting this on our Facebook page. And we will be sending it to Dr. Kriplani so she can post it on her Facebook page. And she can have some and hear some comments and compliments from all her friends and followers.
Thank you.
So, Dr. Kriplani, I just want to say thank you so much for your time. This was a very meaningful session for all of us. And I think we really got to learn a lot in this very little time.
I would say thank you very much for your excellent questions. I'm pretty sure by your looks only many people will log in. And, and
you're too kind.
Thank you very much for all the viewers for sparing your time. For being with us, and it's an absolute pleasure to be with everyone.
It was an absolute honor for me to be the host, Dr. Kriplani, and I just want to say bye. Before I say bye, I would just like to tell you that honestly, you're one of the kindest and most beautiful women I've ever seen, inside out. So thank you so much for being that wonderful doctor, and we look forward to seeing you soon again.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And thank you,
everybody.
Paras Hospital, for giving this opportunity. Yes. We could chat and enjoy. I also enjoyed your questions. So thanks, Paras Gurgaon, for this excellent opportunity. Thank you, Achan. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Who is a visionary and who is really wonderfully managing this Paras show. Sometimes I wonder how many talented people are around.
Many. So, well, again, this is an opportunity to thank all those people behind the scenes who've made this possible. We've had a couple of rehearsals for this.
It's a really wonderful facility. Everybody knows I never lie. It's a wonderful hospital. It's a wonderful administration. It is wonderful ownership of Dr. Dharmender Nagar, who is running this so effortlessly and so meaningful. First thing they say, we want to have good, affordable care provided to our patients. So I'm really very happy working in this place.
So we are also happy to be a part of this, and I'm sure so are our viewers. Once again, we want to thank Paras Health. Make sure that you follow Paras Health on Instagram, on their Facebook page, and stay updated. Ask your questions. Great place to go for consultation. Excellent place for any of your problems that you have. We will be seeing you next week with some more questions, with maybe Dr. Kriplani or another doctor to answer to any of your queries. Once again, thank you so much, Dr. Kriplani. Thank you. And everybody, you all have a great day and a brilliant 2021. Lots of love and blessings from Paras Health.
Thank you.
Thank you.